Hi, this presentation is going to go over frequency distributions and their graphs. A frequency distribution is a useful table as it shows the number of cases falling within a particular class or category of a variable. And we see here that, for instance, we have four people in the first class, which includes the values 1 to 4, and so forth. And therefore, the frequency distribution is a very useful way for helping us to understand the distribution of cases across classes. Within the frequency distribution classes, we can note that there is an interval of values. In this case, they're equal, as they should be, ranging from 1 to 4. And so we can see the formula here for calculating the class width, which is really just the range of values within the interval. If you wanted to construct a frequency distribution, you'd have to first decide the number of classes to include. And an important part of that is just looking at the total number of values. If there are many, maybe you want to have wider class widths. If there are only a few, maybe you just go with narrower class width. The second step is to find the class width as follows. Determine the range of the data, divide the range by the number of classes, round up to the next convenient number. And this is going to give us a little more systematic way of developing our ranges within the classes. So that will require us to find the class limits. You want to have a minimum and a maximum value from that. You will then make a tally mark for each data entry in the row of the appropriate class and then summarize those, right? Add those together, and you'll get your frequency. So in this example, we have 30 students who are taking a statistics class, and they're all a bunch of different ages. Normally at our college, we would see a tighter distribution, so this is quite an impressive range of age values for students. Perhaps it's a night class. Since we already know from the problem the number of classes we want to figure out, we can easily look at the number of cases, which is 36, and divide that by 5. That gives us 7.2, and we can round that up to 8. So to construct our classes, we begin with the lowest value, which was 18. That was the youngest student in the class. And we then add 8 for each of the classes. So the lower class limits are going to be 18 plus 8, 26. 26 plus 8, 34, and so on. And the upper limits, we have the range from 18 to 25, right? And so you can see how this staggers from the upper limit of the first class to the lower limit of the second class. We would then make a tally mark for each of the data entry in the appropriate classes, summarize those tallies by adding them together. Here's what that looks like. And we see that the majority of people in this class are between the age of 18 and 25, which is the traditional age of college students. We call them traditional students. And then we have a few that are older, and it trails off in a very skewed direction, getting progressively smaller. And at the end, we have the sum total, which is the sum of all the frequencies, 30 students in the class. The midpoint of a class, the part that you would find in the middle, is the sum of the lower and upper limits divided by 2. So not too tricky there. If you have a 1 and a 4, you add those together. That's 5. You divide that by 2, 2.5. And returning to our example, we can find the midpoints by adding together these limits, 18 plus 25 divided by 2. That gives us 21.5. And you can do that for each of the remaining rows. Now, thus far, we've only been focusing on the raw frequency. That is the number of cases within the class. Now, equally important, and sometimes more importantly for interpretation, is looking at the relative frequency. So what percentage or proportion of cases fall within that class. And the way we find that is simply by dividing the number of cases for the class by the total number. And returning to our example of students in the statistics course, we can now figure out the relative frequency of each class as a category of the course. And so we see that the largest frequency should also correspond to the highest relative frequency. Another useful measure is the cumulative frequency, which simply adds cases up as we move down through the classes. So the first class, of course, is going to equal the frequency in that class, because we've only seen 13 students so far. But as we go down, we're going to be adding additional students until we get to the end, and that should equal the grand total of 30 students in the class. Sometimes it's useful to visualize our data. So a frequency histogram is a way to display the frequencies within classes. And this is a horizontal scale that is quantitative and measures data values. The vertical scale is the number of cases within each class. And 3 is the consecutive bars must touch. Okay, those are the things we need to consider. We need to identify the class boundaries as one of the steps in creating the histogram of the frequency distribution. And this example shows how we can do that for our example, where we have the different students by age category. And there's the class boundaries. And subtract half a point for the boundary. And when we're ready, we can create our frequency histogram for our distribution of students in the statistics class by age. And this is what it looks like. We have our first class with 13 individuals, which range in age from 18 to 26. But we've got the half subtracted there to make room for the line boundary. And then the next class has the same sort of distinction. And this is how it looks. And you'll notice we're looking here at the actual frequencies and not the proportions or percentages. We can also examine the frequency polygon, which also displays our data, but in a more continuous way with this line connecting all of the points. And so there we have the same data displayed here by points on a line. And now we go to the relative frequency histogram, which has a similar shape, as it should. This time, though, we're using the proportion instead of the number of cases within each class. The cumulative frequency graph should always look like this, where it approaches a limit, which is the total number in the sample that we're examining.